Boker Tov, welcome to Kol Elavat Israel. Good morning. We are doing the class again, the daily class of Mishneh LaTorah from the Harambam. It's from the new book we got, Baruch Hashem, as we mentioned before, from Rabbi Yechiel Kabili. It's a fantastic newest addition to the 613 mitzvot that we're going to deal today. We're going to go back to, I understand we had a glitch yesterday, so forgive us. We're going to go back to Kuf Peichet, but before, as usual, Be'ezat Hashem, we're going to do a bracha for the people that need refuah shlema, Be'ezat Hashem. We're going to do a special refuah shlema, first and foremost, to our patient who just received a heart transplant. Be'ezat Hashem, for Eliezer ben Le'am, to our dear sponsor and friend, Bernie Baruch, Chai ben Miriam, ben Chaya Miriam, to our sponsor, Ephraim ben Devorah, and to Shulamit Bat Tzipora and Karen Bat Aliza, Flori Bat Rachel, Chaim Ben Raymond, Yachad Im Kol Chole Amcha Israel, and all the patients that unfortunately received the corona that affected by the virus. May God protect and save them and heal them, Be'ezat Hashem, together with all the people of the world. And may we merit to have a geula in the month of Nisan. As we know, Be'ezat Hashem, this is the month of geula, as the people of Israel came out of Egypt and redeemed from Egypt. Be'ezat Hashem, may we merit the same redemption this month of Nisan. So, Be'ezat Hashem, as we said, we are back to Kuf Peichet, which is 188. As we mentioned before, we have to destroy Amalek. And of course, this is a mitzvah from the Oraita. This is what Hashem says, that we are obligated to do that. And by the way, destroying Amalek is not just, as we know, Amalek comes from different nations. It comes from different worlds, so to speak. For an example, you have Amalek with, as we know, when they came out of Egypt. There is Amalek with Shaul. There is Amalek with Haman. And in all time, because we were far from Hashem. You know, the word Amalek is an acronym. Am Moel Lo Kadosh, a nation, the Jewish nation that stray and not holy. So Hashem brings Amalek upon us, Chaz v'Chalila. But remember, after every Amalek, as we mentioned, there is a big Yeshua. The first Amalek that came for Moshe Rabbeinu in Rafidim. After that, we got the Torah, and of course, we built the Mishkan. And the second time, when we have with Shaul, after that, of course, we have the King David and King Solomon. King Solomon built the first temple, the Mikdash HaRishon. And the third time with Haman, Yimach Shmo V'Shem Zichro HaGagi, which is Amalek. As we know, with Mordechai and Esther, we rebuild the second temple. And Be'ezat Hashem will continue this time around. We see the Amalek around the world that goes against Israel will receive the third and final Bet HaMikdash. So, and now with 189, Kuf Peited, Liskor Mashiach Asa Amalek, Shetamit Zachor Est Asher Asa Lecha Amalek. It's a mitzvah to destroy, but also to remember. So, you know, what's the Rambam says, what is the Liskor? Vele Haskir. The Rambam says you have to remember and remind everybody else, not to Chaz V'Chalila. We have to conquer our own Amalek in our, you know, in our Yetzer Hara. It's also part of Amalek. We have to conquer this and defeat it every day. And La'asot milchamat harashut kemishpat hakatub batorah shenemar ki tikrav elayir. This is Kuf Tzadik 190. The mitzvah says that we are obligated to what we call do a war מלחמת הרשות. As we saw, we have two kinds of war. There is war of necessity and a war of choice, right? If somebody come to attack you, this is you have to protect yourself, right? Or in the case that you, Chas v'chalila, you know, as we know, not Chas v'chalila, when Hashem says you come to the land of Israel and you remove the occupiers, so to speak, the seven nations, this is, you know, a war of necessity, but, you know, a war of Rashut, I'm sorry, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu allowed us to do this war. And just, you know, in the past, when the people of Israel went to war, they were all righteous. Nobody died in wars. Very, very, very few wars, if any, in the beginning. And I'm talking about the day of, you know, Moshe Rabbeinu and Yehoshua. And we see that, you know, because the faith was so amazing, close to Hashem, that only righteous people went to war. You know, that's why it says, Ish Lamate, Ish Lamate. As we know, when there was a war of necessity, there were tzaddikim, you know, 100% righteous people went to war. The Gemara will tell us that they wore the tefillin on head and hand and the tzitzit, and they went to war when the goyim saw that they were terrified of them. And as we know, there was, you know, warriors, both of, you know, what we call the warriors of Israel, like today, IDF, and also the war Tzvaot Hashem, also, which is the warriors of Torah, meaning that they will pray and fight with blessings, and we call the yeshiva boys, the Avrachim today. We see that HaKadosh Baruch Hu allow us to win many, many wars. We are the only nation in the world that won all the wars. Regardless, yes, sometimes we were, you know, we suffered a lot of things, but we won every war until today. You know, we're still in existence where no other nation has. Everybody's completely gone from the world, but the people of Israel are still here. No matter how big, you know, countries and everything like that, no matter how much weapons they have, they're all gone with the, you know, Machshma v'Shem Zichram, you know, the Nazis, and then, you know, the Spaniards, or the Christians, Crusaders, or the Russian, you know, all of those are gone from the world, or Romans, or the Greeks, they're all gone, you know. By the way, today's nations, just so you know, they are not the original nations. There was a king named Sancheriv, and Sancheriv actually was one of the 10 kings that ruled the world. And he mixed the entire people of the world. He took people out of their own land and put them in different lands. And when they asked him, why does he do that? He said, because people who do not live in their own land will never fight for their another person's land. You know, that's why we have, you know, the understanding that those nations today are not really the real nations. As we said, Sancheriv mixed the whole world. Let's continue. קוף צדיק א' 191 למשוח כהן למלחמה שנאמר והיה כקורבן אל המלחמה וניגש הכהן. So one of the mitzvah is to anoint the kohen, you know, the priest, the kohen used to be anointed. There's a special anointment oil that was only dedicated to the kohanim and to the vessels of the mikdash, and when the war is come, they used to be anointed by this cream special oil that made out of the ketoret, some part of the ketoret. And he says, this kohen, Rambam says, limshoach kohen la'milchama, limnot kohen la'oded et ha'lochamim ha'yotzim la'milchama. This is actually in order to, what we call, encourage and entice the warriors to, you know, fight and be faithful and to have emunah in Hashem. As we know, Hashem says, Adonai ilachem lachem v'atem tacharishun. Hashem will do the wars and you plow in the Torah. We know many times in the history of the Jewish people, we were very little outmatched by any equipment or military, you know, forces or airplanes or tanks, but we won all the wars. Why? Because Hashem fights for us. And we know we have documented, you know, from Yom Kippur and the Six-Day War of, you know, Arab generals, both from Egypt and Syria, testifying there was, angels coming from the heavens, ascending down to earth and asking them to leave before they'll destroy them. And that's why many of them left their tanks and weapons and ran back. And the people of Israel did not understand what's going on. You know, there's, you can look at it at the Rabbi YouTube, you can Google that, you'll see the videos. You can also find it on our Facebook, you know, and you'll see the video there. But in reality, this Kohen was anointed for, you know, to encourage the soldiers not to have fear and to fight. And Kuf Tzadik Bet 192, Lehatkin Yad Bamachane, Sheneemar, Veyad Tiyelach Michutz Lamachane. You know, what's Yad? You know, we know Yad is a hand, right? You know, but it's actually not what it means. You know, the Rambam would explain what's a Yad. When you go to war, you, or any, you know, wherever you have camps or whatever the case may be, Yad means a place that the soldiers can go and do their private needs, go to the bathroom and such. You know, it's a Yad is a mitzvah, again, to give it outside of the camp, not inside, it has to be outside. And 193 Kuf Tzadigime Latkin Yated Shenemar Veyatet Yelacha Al Oznecha. What's Yated? You know, as we know that, you know, the after building this area or dedicating area for a bathroom and the private needs, you have to have a shovel, you know, like that to cover what you do. It's very interesting, you know, they say that we can learn, you know, from three animals in the Gemara, the ant, the cat, and the rooster, and the cat is because how clean she is, and she covers always her, you know, when she goes to the bathroom in order to do. This is a mitzvah to cover that. And again, this is, look how beautiful our Torah, even at the little things, pay attention to every detail. Kuf Tzadik Dalet, now the Rambam is moving into what we call Midot Ben Adam Lachavero, you know, is the way we should behave towards each other, you know. You know, the midot, the word midot, characters in Hebrew, if you rearrange the letters, it means demut. It's your reflection. The way you behave towards your friends is really who you are, how you're reflected by other people. You know, many people can look at a person and have certain understanding of who they are instantly, whether, you know, they're nice or not. There's certain things that, you know, you as a person, by your inside character traits, you emanate the outside, so to speak, the glow of you, the aura of you. So it says, when it comes to, now we are at the Kuf Tzadik Dalet, which is 194, Lehashiv et hagezel, sheneemar, veshiv et hagezela, asher gazal. So as we know, Chaz v'chalila, if you steal something, you have to return it. You know, the halacha, according to the Torah, if you steal $100, you have to pay back 200, double. You know, and it says here, you have to return it. Remember, this is not a, you know, you're not allowed to steal. It's one of the Ten Commandments, you shall not steal, which is, you know, of course, has many connotations to it. And of course, it's Kuf Tzadik Hei. It says, Laten Tzedakah, Shenemar Patuach Tiftach Et Yadecha. You know, it's a big and important thing to give Tzedakah. You know, Tzedakah is not a choice. Many people think that, oh, it's only if I can or not. Even poor people have to give tzedakah. HaKadosh Baruch Hu give you this opportunity, you know, to give tzedakah is really to save life, you know. When you give tzedakah, you honor Hashem at the highest level, when meaning that you have faith. You have an emunah in HaKadosh Baruch Hu that what He gave you, if you give to others and help, He'll give you more. You know, you're like what in the eyes of God or in our today's, you know, understanding. You're like, you know, an investment account. If you yield more mitzvot, Hashem will give you more money so you can do more mitzvot. Remember, if you have a full cup, right, you're holding a full cup of water and you don't share with others, it still stay full. But if you share, Hashem fill it up. So you can make out of this cup 100 cups. You know, tzedakah is a big mitzvah to give tzedakah. You know, it's the word tzedek Hashem, right? Tzedakah is tzedek Hashem. Hashem tzedak, it gives you the opportunity to save your life and to save others. And they say, when you don't have money on you, you don't have tzedakah, first and foremost, it is most important to welcome people that come for tzedakah. Be kind to them. And don't think you've been doing a big deed if you give them a dollar. What's a dollar? Nobody can do anything with a dollar. You need to give them enough to eat, enough to whatever there is they need. And if you don't have, say, please give me your address, I'll send you a check. And always be kind to them and be nice to them. Remember, this is a test from Hashem to see who you are and how you behave towards each other. This is Ben Adam Lachavero, between men and men. And the Zohar says that a person that, you know, all of a sudden somebody came to them out of nowhere asking for tzedakah that they never met in their life, this is actually one of their family member in the past life, is a gilgul that they owed, and they come to do, give you opportunity to do a mitzvah. so you can fix a tikkun for the mitzvah. And then we'll move, you know, liten, the Rambam says, to give as much as you can. You know, forget the 10%. Yes, that's nice. That's a commitment that we have to do, sometimes even 20%. But if you could do more, do more. Remember, whatever you have, it's not because of you. It's because Hashem does chesed with you. Hashem does not like to give tzedakah. But in this world, he gives you a little reward so you understand that really the world of mitzvot is the rewards in the world to come. Let's continue with Kuf Tzadik Vav 196. להעניק לעבד עברי, שנאמר להעניק תעניק לו, וכן לאמה עברייה. So we are obligated, of course, to, you know, if God forbid a person has to become a slave, you know, in the old days, there is what we call the a person that if, let's say, a man or woman stole and they cannot pay back, they became slaves until they pay their dues. And you know, as we know, it says that in the Torah, shesh shanim ta'avod u'bashana shvi'i tetze l'chofshi chinam. As we know, the obligation, you know, in without you know any other condition at this moment, a person that is a slave for 6 years, the master has to supply them with everything, so to speak, their home and the clothes and the food and medicine, shelter, everything that they need for them or their family altogether. He says you have to, you know why? Because, you know, in reality, the master is also a slave. Imagine, you have to take care of everything they need. They just go to sleep and work and that's it. You have to supply everything. So in reality, it says only if the Eved Ivri, you know, in this case, wanted to stay, as we know, you have to, you know, put a hole in their ear with the oar, right? The marzea. It's very interesting. The word marzea in Gematria is 400. To elude the 400 of years that Hashem was promised Abraham of slavery. And they say people that want to still remain slaves, they never left Egypt, Chas v'Chalila. And you have to give them everything that they need. 197, Lehalvot la'ani, shenemar, im kesef talve et ami, et ha'ani, im ze eno reshut ela mitzvah, shenemar, so it says that we are obligated to lend money to poor people. Remember, even if you think, well, they cannot pay me now or they don't have it, it's an obligation to lend money to poor people. When the Torah says im, if, it's not im meaning like if, it's actually you have to, it's a condition. As we said, the Rambam says, "Avet avitenu kabel mimenu avot." You can, if you want, you can ask for collateral, but lend them the money. 196, להלוות לנוכרי בריבית שנאמר לנוכרי תשית מפי השמועה למדו שזו מצוות עשה. So you know, to a goy, you allowed to charge interest, unlike with the Jew that keeps Shabbat and a religious Jew, you're not allowed. The Gemara will teach us that a person that charge interest of a Jew that's Shomer Shabbat and Shomer Torah and mitzvot have no share to the world to come. On the other hand, technically, halachically, if a person does not keep Shabbat, does not keep the laws, does not, you allow a Jewish guy to charge interest. And of course, here, it speaks of nochri, of a Gentile, you're allowed to charge him interest. You know, tashit is talbe berivit, the beribit in interest. You know, it's very interesting to understand that today in Israel, for example, the question, how can, you know, bank charge interest of Jewish people? So the Rabbanim is doing this as a part of a partnership agreement. When you get a credit card or loan from the bank, it's like a partner. They become partner with you. They share the risk with you. Kuf Tzadik Tet 199, להשיב המשכון לבעליו, שנאמר, השב תשיב את האבות. So, you know, if you are taking any collateral, you have to return it to them. The Rambam says, להשיב בזמן שהוא צריך לו. Let's say you took a collateral from somebody and they still owe you money and they haven't paid you full and they need this collateral in order to survive, in order to do something. You need to return that to them. It says, even though it's a mashkon, ha'ravon chefet shenoten halove l'avtachat achzer la'alva'a. The importance of this mitzvah that we have to, even the collateral material has to be returned. 200, resh, we got to the mitzvah of 200. Liten sachar, שכיר בזמנו שנאמר ביומו תיתן שכרו. You know, it's a big obligation. Never, אסור להלין שכר. You never allowed not to pay a person that works for you. If, let's say, if a daily worker, you have to pay them at the end of the day. If it's a weekly, at the end of the week. Whatever you agree to has to be paid. You cannot hold their payment. As remember, these people need, and all of us need money, especially now in these days of corona and complete closure all over the world, as we see people lost their homes and jobs and God forbid so much many things. By the way, speaking of that, I urge you, if you could, God bless you, we work as every year with a couple yeshivot in Israel and one in Los Angeles, and here in San Diego we feed about 96 families for Pesach. So if you could kindly, we really, really appreciate your help. It's only $72 for a 4-people meal of Seder Pesach. Of course, it costs more for the rest of the week. But whatever you could do, if you go to our website, neshatorah.org, go to the mitzvah section, you'll be so, so gladly and appreciative by this family if you can help them. We help them every year, of course, with great other people that donate. So, but we're very short this year, given the situation. So God bless you if you could do that. Really appreciate it. All right, so 201, Resh Aleph, להיות השכיר אוכל בזמן שכירותו, שנאמר, כי תבוא בקרן רעך, כי תבוא בקמת רעך. You know, let's say you hire somebody to work for you and you have a field that has fruit or whatever, they're allowed to eat from those fruit when they work. You cannot say, don't touch the fruit. If a people work and picking up apples for you and, you know, they want to have an apple, it's an obligation to feed them. 202, לעזוב מעל חברו או מעל בהמתו שנאמר, עזוב תעזוב עמו. So we see that we are obligated to help and to, let's say, you see your enemy's donkey falling under the weight and the weight fell from, you got to go help them, even though if it's your enemy, it doesn't matter. The Rambam says here, what does it mean? לעזוב, לעזור לפרוק מסע שנפל בדרך מעל בהמה עמוסה. It's our obligation to go and help and, you know, relieve the tension of this, you know, animal and help your enemy to pick up their stuff. You know, look how the beautiful Hashem is. Even with, you know, times when you have chas v'chalila, person you don't like, but something happened to their animal. This Tzar Baal Chaim, we are the only religion in the world that has what we call the love to animals, the caring of animals. As we know, we're obligated to, you know, give food to animals before we eat, and we're obligated to give them water after we drink. We learn this from Rivka with the water, we learn from Yaakov with the food. So this is really a beautiful religion. Hashem gave us such a beautiful religion that we are the only religion in the world that mentions anything that has to do with taking care of animals, so to speak. And we are in 203 Resh Gimel. As we said, להקים המסע לבהמה שנאמר, הקם, obligation is, if, again, an animal that dropped the stuff, and you have to help. להקים זה להטעין, is to basically put the stuff back on it and make sure that it's easy for them to walk and everything is tied correctly. רש דלת 204, להשיב העבדה שנאמר, השף תשיבם לאחיך. Is, you know, if you find something that's lost, it's an obligation to return this lost item. Of course, you make sure that it's the right and owner, you know, rightful owner. Of course, you have to ask them to give you some signs of what, you know, when people lose something, is a big thing, especially wallets and things like that that could ruin their life. Chas v'chalila, you must always find who it belongs to. I, amazingly, you know, in the last year, found a wallet twice. It was the same person in two different locations. And Baruch Hashem, you know, we returned it. He's a Muslim guy that, you know, he saw a rabbi returning his stuff. He was had a whole different outlook on Judaism. He invited me to his home. He said, please let me do a meal for you. I really appreciate it. This is the second time. I don't know how to thank you. And I said, no worries, all from Shamayim. Don't worry, you know, we're, you know, all children of God, and we need to have, you know, respect and return a lost item. It was a very amazing experience. Resh Hay is 205. Leochiach achote shenemar, ochiach tochiach et amitecha. You know, when a person has a sin, right, and they keep doing it, it's an obligation for us to tell them, you know, listen, quietly first. You know, by the way, it's a big mitzvah to do it quietly, just the two of you, says, you know, you're doing these things, it's not good, try to fix it right away, do a tshuva. And if you have a person, chas v'chalila, that keeps doing this bad thing, stealing from people, or, you know already, it's called like the laws of Shor Muad, is an ox that gorged many times. There's only so many times you can forgive. And you have to actually warn other people. If you know that this person keeps stealing, and you have an absolute 100% proof, and you know that it's been done to many people, you're allowed to warn them. Mocheach tochiach et amitecha, as we says. Resh Vav 206. Lehov kol adam mibnei brit she'nemar ve'ahavta l'racha kamocha. We are obligated to love, our bnei brit. What's a bnei brit? The Jewish people. To love them as we love ourselves. You know, it's very interesting. Many people don't, maybe not noticing how this words is written. You know, it says ve'ahavta l'racha kamocha. It doesn't say ve'ahavta et racha. It's very hard to love your friend as you love yourself. What the Rabbi Akiva teaches us in the Zohar, something amazing. It says, as we know, to love your friend as you love yourself is nearly impossible. You know, we always, forgive ourselves for many things. But if your friend, Chas v'Chalila, you've been friends for 10, 15, 20 years, he said something wrong, he did something wrong, you completely shun them and you don't talk to them anymore and you hate them in your heart, and God forbid that happens with family members and such, how can you love a friend like you love yourself? So first and foremost, he said le reacha, meaning don't do things that's done to you that you don't like to others. This is the really the understanding. But Rabbi Akiva, the Zohar says le afta le reacha kamocha, is actually loving your yetzer ara. It's very amazing. He says, Rabbi Akiva, le'reacha means your own evil inclination. How do you fight Yetzer Hara? You cannot defeat Yetzer Hara with war. You can defeat Yetzer Hara only with love and Torah. As Hashem says, barati Yetzer Hara ve'barati lo tavlin. I created, evil inclination, but I also created an antidote for it. Is the Torah, is learning Torah. So Rabbi Akiva says, when you tie your tefillin every morning, le'reacha, small on your left hand, could be the right hand if you are lefty, is the small end, is what we call Samael. This is Yetzer Hara, is the Satan. Nahon is another name. By the way, it's interesting that Islam, the word Islam is the letter Samael, Yetzer Hara and Satan. And when you tie the tefillin on it, Rabbi Akiva says, Zichrono Levracha, you love him. He says, look, I love you. I do Torah with you. And they say, Yetzer Hara leaves a person that has Torah in him. They have nothing to do with this person. They don't want to be because they know they're going to lose. So they go to the next person that has, Chas v'Chalila, sins. It's easier for the Yetzer Hara. Don't be like that. Be the one that Yetzer Hara want to get away from you. And they say, Rasha, take him to Beit HaMidrash. If a wicked person come to you, bring them to Beit HaMidrash. This is how you're going to fix them. Resh Zayin, which is 207, Lehov et ager she'nemar, ve'aftem et ager. It's a mitzvah to love the ger tzedek. Ger is a person that makes tshuva and convert to the Jewish people. As we know, very, very important. We have many, many teaching. Hashem, in three occasions, said about three kinds of people that he will personally avenge them. If you, Chas v'Chalila, hurt them, or steal from them, or insult them, whatever the case may be. The ger, yatom ve'almana. The ger tzedek, the convert, the orphan, and the widow. Hashem says, if you do that, I will make you a slave, a ger, like you used to be. I will make you a widow, or I'll make you an orphan, Chas v'Chalila. It's a mitzvah. When people realize how many of our righteous people and our biggest rabbis actually came from converts. If you take, for an example, from Sancheriv came Shmalia v'Avtalion. They were the teacher of Hillel and Shammai. We have Rabbi Meir Balanes. He came from Neron, a Roman Empire. Rabbi Meir Balanes, Rabbi Akiva, Zichrono Levracha, and all of them. Rabbi Akiva came from Cicero. When Cicero, raped Yael, The Zohar says Yael cut his head off just because he raped her so many times that night, and from them later on, from a few generations in the future, will come Rabbi Akiva, you know. And of course we know Onkelos. Onkelos was a Roman, you know, noble and a prince. You know, they say when Yaakov Avinu, after 36 years that he was outside of the land and came to Esav, he bowed to him 7 times, right? He bowed to him 7 times. So our sages, if I'm not mistaken, the Ben Ish Chai says that, and also Mei Marom, the book Mei Marom, it says that Yaakov Avinu bowed to Esav 7 times for the 7 tzaddikim that will come from Edom. You know? 7 righteous people that will come from the Edomites. You know, that actually big giants. By the way, there is also from even Haman HaRasha, you know, from Haman HaGagid, Amalekite. From him will come 2 grandkids that will be giants of Torah in Bnei Brak, Rabbi Shmuel Bar Shilat and his brother. Rabbi Shmuel Bar Shilat, he is the one that says the famous, Mishenichnas Adar Marbim Besimcha. Mishenichnas Av Mam'itim Besimcha. That's him. This is the Tzeitza of Haman HaRasha. So we have to give respect to the Ger. And the Resh Chet, which is 208, Letzedek Hamoznaim Mishkalot, Shenema Mozne Tzedek, Evans Avnei Tzedek. You know, you have to be very careful when you use what we call the weights to sell something. Let's say you sell 100 kilo of something, you have to be exactly 100 kilo. It cannot be 99, it cannot be a 98. There's a story in New Jersey, I heard from my rabbi there. There was a guy that was supplying, you know, in wholesale bags, you know, for shopping bags, when people buy 100 extra of those, and he always used to put 90, 92, 93, and he used to steal from him hundreds and hundreds of clients. And one day he heard a shiur from a rabbi, Yosef Mizrahi, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yishmor Oto V'Yizakeh Oto Le'Atzlachot. And he heard this class, and the guy was shocked to his core about stealing and how Elohim Yishmor, you know, it's very hard to make tshuva if you steal like that, and you machti arabim, you do a lot of averot with many, many people. So this gentleman, this manufacturer in New Jersey, decided to make tshuva. So he made tshuva, but very sincere tshuva. And he went to his rabbi and he told him the story. He says, listen, I've been stealing all the time for many years. What should I do? How can I repay this? The rabbi says, it's nearly impossible, but you could do something different. From now on, manufacture over 10% over what you get. If you have people pay for 100, you give them 110 at least. And so exactly happened. After 2 years, you know, of supplying everybody again, everything that he stole, you know, so to speak, he actually is still giving back. In New Jersey, they had a TV show where they wanted to see who is an honest manufacturer. They took all kinds of companies and they saw how much the advertising and product, you know, as far as quantities, and they start checking companies. Companies of toilet paper, you know, bags, all kinds of companies of manufacturers. And from all of them, he was the only one that was giving more than advertised. So they came and did an interview with him, and really it was a Kiddush Hashem, a Jewish guy that gives more, and everyone said, wow, this is so nice. That means really his tshuva was received in the heavens. So you're not allowed to steal in the weight. Remember, it's like buying gold. You have to be very careful. Every gram and gram has to be counted. And needless to say, when we say we ask too, is, you know, when we do business, we have to be very honest. If you promise something in the words, it's as if you had a contract. You know, many people promise and don't keep their word, and they think, oh, I did not pay what I owed, and, you know, forget these people, I don't need to pay, I don't have a contract, but I said it, but it doesn't matter. In reality, believe me, God will take a lot more back from you for what you did not pay and do. So let's continue. Resh Tet 209, Lechabed HaChachamim, Sheneemar, Mipnei Seva Takum, is an obligation to respect, you know, Chachamim. You know, Chachamim is not people like us and you and I. It's a big Rabbanim we're talking. But of course, people that teach Torah, people that really, their life dedicated to Torah, they're Chachamim, you know. what's the word chacham? Chacham is a very interesting word. It is an acronym. You know, chacham, chatzi kos melea. He always positive. He sees the glass is half full, not half empty. He's a person that have trust in Hashem. Mipnei seiva takum, you know, meaning that, you know, first it has two mitzvot in it. If you see an older person, you know, come to, for an example, the train or whatever the case, maybe you have to let them sit, get up from your seat. Even when an old person come to shul, you have to stand up and give them the kavod. And let's continue. You know, they say, or the Rambam says, what's hachachamim is hem yodea Torah umelamdea leacherim. A person that learn Torah and teach others is considered chacham. I myself go by the word Talmid. Only when you're Talmid you can be a chacham, as we know. You cannot be a chacham before you are a Talmid, a student. And every day, student of Hashem, not once in a while. You have to do, you know, the Torah has so many secrets and teaching. A lifetime you cannot even grasp, you know, 1/1,000,000th of it. But whatever you can do to teach others, that's what the King Solomon, Shlomo HaMelech, wrote in Shir HaShirim, if I'm not mistaken, or in Mishlei. Adam la'amal yulad. A person is born to work, right? Wrong. Yeah, of course you need to work, but la'amal is an acronym. Lilmod al menat lelamed. You came to this world to learn in order to teach. Because, you know, everybody needs teaching. Your children, your friends, your neighbors. Of course, it's a mitzvah to learn Torah in order to teach. And they say people that know Torah and don't teach, the Gemara says, is like hadas b'midbar. They are like a beautiful smelling bush that we use for Havdalah that smells so nice. But in a desert, nobody knows about them. Nobody knows about their Torah. Nobody can smell their beautiful, you know, Divrei Torah, Divrei Chochmah. Resh Yud 2:10, lechabed avaem, shenemar kabed et avicha ve et imecha. So as we know, it's a big mitzvah to respect our parents. There is two mitzvot in the Torah. It says lema'an yarichun yamecha, so you have long life. One of them is respecting your parents. And the second is what we call shiluach haken, right? If you come upon a bird nest and you want to take the eggs or the chicks, you have to hush away the mother. A very cruel thing, so to speak, right? The Zohar will explain to us, what is this? This is really a mitzvah to teach you that, you know, the mother is really the neshama. And the chicks or the eggs are your body. You want to separate the two. You want to shluach neshama. You want to tell your neshama, go, I want to be mundane. I want to deal with this, you know, behemic life. No, you have to really be careful. And we know there is a famous story in the Gemara about Rabbi Yochanan Kohen Gadol. You know, Rabbi Yochanan Kohen Gadol, as we know, the Shevet Yehuda, the father of Matityahu and Banav and the Hashmonaim. You know, he was 80 years Kohen Gadol, 80 years high priest. And one day he said, you know, to his son, he says to him, I'm going to give you a chance to make two mitzvot in one shot, leman yarechun yamecha, so you have long life. You do respecting your parents, but you also do shiluach haken. I want you to go up to this tree. He pointed to him, Rabbi Yochanan, Kohen Gadol, to his son. He says, I want you to go up and do shiluach haken, hush the mother and bring me the eggs, and you'll have long life. And of course, the son, needless to say, listens to his father. He goes up to the tree. It was a tall tree, and the son fell and died. And Rabbi Yochanan actually complained to Hashem, and he says, this is Torah, v'ziz sachara, this is the Torah, and this is the reward. I sent him to do mitzvot for long life, and he's dead now. You killed him. What's going on, Hashem? And by the way, this is also Moshe Rabbeinu said about Rabbi Akiva, when he saw into the future that Rabbi Akiva will be one of the 10th, you know, righteous people that will die by the Romans. He says, this is Torah, v'ziz sachara. But of course, we don't understand Hashem's ways. And just so you know, Rabbi Yochanan left Hashem. He became a tzedoki in his late day, and he died without tshuva. But his children, the Gaonim and the Chachamim, Kohen Gadol, as we know, we say on Chanukah in the Amidah, it says, you know, Bimei Matityahu Kohen Gadol, Yochanan Kohen Gadol Uvanav, they actually put him in the prayers and made such a tshuva for him that they returned him to heaven. This is amazing, you know, the children can do something for our parents. Chas v'chalila, if you have parents that, you know, don't keep Shabbat or anything like that, you're allowed to do studies for them, Tehillim, and with your mitzvot throughout your life, you can bring them back to heaven. It's an amazing teaching. We learned this from Avraham Avinu, Zichrono Livracha. You know, Avraham, when he was about to die, Hashem told him, you're going to be with your father, with Avotecha. Avraham was in shock. He says, what do you mean I'm going to be in the heavens with my father? My father is Terach. Hashem, you forgot, he was the idol worshiper of the world. He was the Costco of idol worshiping, manufacturing and selling, distributing all over the world. Hashem says to him, your mitzvot and your deeds and your nisyonot, the 10 tests that you put through and everything that you devoted to the people of Israel and to the Jewish people in the future, you merited to bring your father into heaven. It's amazing. Maaseh, you know, the children can change maasim shel avotehem. Let's continue. Resh Yud Aleph, 211. Leira me'av ve'em, she'ne'emar, ish et imo ve'aviv tira'u. You know, it's a very, very big obligation to fear your parents out of respect. And of course, you know, when you say lechabed, what is, you know, I mean, leira, I'm sorry, the Rambam says, lo ya'aseh ma'asim ha'pogayim bechvodam. You are not allowed to do chaz v'chalila things that will... You know, remember, when we leave the house, all of us, we represent the Jewish people, we represent Hashem, we represent our parents. When we do something bad, it's reflection on our parents. Whether they're alive or not, they see it. And it hurts them in wherever they are in the heavens to see, chas v'chalila, their children do some bad things. You have to be cautious with what you do. It's a mitzvah. And the yirah is not to do things that would hurt them. Even they're with you or not, it doesn't matter. Let alone, of course, chas v'chalila, when they're with you, you don't do anything. They say, of course, in the Torah, we know, even if you curse your parents, mot yumat. Chas v'chalila, if a person cursed their parents, is death from this world and the world to come. Resh Yud Bet, you know, this is now, the Rambam is moving to the mitzvot of the mishpacha, of the family. You know, make no mistake, the Zohar will teach us that when the neshamot came to the certain mishpacha, when this group of people get together out of nowhere, you have children, different neshamot, you are different, you are from a different nation, different place, different city, it doesn't matter. Hashem put you together because you all were connected in a past life as a gilgulim to fix your life now. Remember, everything that you have today as far as your children is given to you in order to fix. You know, we know there's a famous story with Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes and his amazing, amazing tzaddiket wife, Bruria. You know, on one Shabbat, Rabbi Baal HaNes was studying Torah and, of course, praying. And he didn't know, but his two children, he had two children, they died on Shabbat. And Bruria, his wife, the tzaddiket, took them and put them in the attic and hid them the whole Shabbat. And, you know, the rabbi will ask about them, Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes, say, where are they, where are they? And, you know, the wife, she'll say, but they say, actually, Bruria, his wife, was more righteous and more knowledgeable than Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes. So she said to him, she says, I want to ask you a question, rabbi. She said, if a person give you a collateral, you know, he says, I want you to hold it for me. And one day I'll come and I'll ask for it. I don't know when, but I will come and I'll ask for this collateral. Will you give it back to him? Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes says, of course, I will give it back to him. What kind of question is that? She goes, okay. Come Motzei Shabbat. The rabbi is now looking for his kids to do Havdalah. And the wife says, do the Havdalah and I'll tell you where they are. So he did the Havdalah. Come Motzei Shabbat, she says to him, our children died, and I put him there in the honor of Shabbat, and I didn't want to interrupt your Torah studies or upset you on Shabbat. And Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes, of course, they were sad and crying, but he understood the wisdom of his wife, Bruria. By the way, the name Bruria is Levareria, is to really to teach what Hashem wants us to learn. And, you know, she was so righteous that, of course, even her sister that was taken by the Romans to Chas v'Chalila, to a whorehouse, to, you know, be in a place. She sent him, Rabbi Meir sent him, I mean, his wife sent him to save and rescue his own sister. And he did a test. He dressed like, you know, a goy, and he went to this place and tried to convince her to do a bad deed with him, and she refused, and she keeps telling, I can't, and I don't feel good, and I'm in my womanly period and all that. And only after he made sure that she's really never ever disgraced herself and kept, you know, the tahara, he actually gave one of the keepers of the jail a bag of gold, and he says to him, I promise you, whenever you have trouble, because the goy first did not want to say, well, they're going to kill me, but Rabbi Meir says, whenever something happens, he just says, El had Rabbi Meir aneni, El had Rabbi Meir aneni, El had Rabbi Meir aneni, and you'll be saved. And that's exactly what happened. Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes saved his sister-in-law, and this goy took the gold, and he was saved for many times from the Romans. So let's continue. Now, a mitzvah, as we said, lifrot velirbot, resh yud bet, which is 212, is a mitzvah to have children, pruravu. You know, in the entire book of Bereshit, we have only three mitzvot. The first mitzvah is pruravu, meaning, you know, you have to be married, of course, as we know. Adam veishto, the Torah said they were already married. It was a wife. And pruravu means to have a boy and a girl. It's a mitzvah. They say if you don't have children, you don't have a share of the world to come. Chas v'chalila. It's a big mitzvah. And of course, we said the three mitzvot in Bereshit is pruravu, the brit milah, and the gid hanasheh. You know, you have to have children, you have to do the circumcision, and you're not allowed to eat the sciatic nerve. By the way, the sciatic nerve, just so you know, it is actually where Yetzer Hara resides. The Zohar says that Yetzer Hara in our body reside on the left side of the sciatic nerve. That's why Esav, angel, was fighting with Yaakov all night. He was keep hitting him in the place where Yaakov Avinu hid the deed, the certificate they signed for the purchasing of the Bechorah. And he tried to take it away from him, and he hurt him in the sciatic nerve, and that's why we're not allowed to eat sciatic nerve. They said, the Gemara says in the Shulchan Aruch, that if a person eat the sciatic nerve, as if he ate on Yom Kippur and Chayav Karet, Chas v'Chalila. Resh Yud Gimel, which is 213, Liv'ol Bekidushin Shenemar, Ki Kach Isha Uba'aleh, is a mitzvah to what we have, Liv'ol Bekidushin. You have to, you know, be with your wife, you know, privately, intimately, and the mitzvah of children. And of course, for, you know, pleasure, Hashem says you can do anything you want to do that people think is a sin, you can do it in Kiddushin. If you want to be with a woman, that's fine. Just do it in a Kiddushin. If you want to eat, that's fine. Eat in Kiddushin. You want to celebrate, celebrate in Kiddushin. You want to go on vacation, good. Go to a good Kiddushin place that has separation, men and women. Eat kosher food, you know, have, you know, separation in dancing. It's all allowed. Just do it in Kiddushin. Okay, so the Rambam says, what's livol bekidushin? Adam yachol lavo al isha rak leachar shekidesh ota. You cannot be with a woman unless she is designated to you, that you made her holy for you. Kedat Moshe v'Israel, you say the kidushin. Min ha-Torah mitzvah lekadesh isha yechola leasod bevi'a o v'shtar o bechesef. So we know in the Gemara in Masechet Kiddushin, it says, how you can make a woman designated to you in Kiddushin is when you come upon her, you either do a ketubah or you allocate money for this Kiddushin. Resh Yudalet, v'sameh chatan et ishto shana, sh'neemar, naki yele v'ito shana achad. It's an obligation by a new groom, of course, the whole life, but the first year is to do extra to make his wife very, very happy. Unlike the goyim, they have honeymoon, which is 1 month. We, the Jewish people, have a year. So, the Rambam says that how do you do a simcha? He says, שישהה עם אשתו שנה שלמה לאחר נישואים ולא יעזוב אותה. You have to stay with your wife for 1 year, all the time for the first year. Don't leave her. And you have to, וישמח את ליבה. You have to make her, you know, heart very happy. And by the way, the word love in English comes from the word lev. Lev is a heart. You know, when the lev is full, that means it has heart, is happy, and it has ahava. Ahava, by the way, in Gematria is 13. And they say that a man and a woman, until they get married, they're half. When they get married, they're one. And if you take achad and ahava, in Gematria is 26. Yud kei vav kei. You're really doing the mitzvah of being with a woman. It says, "Lachen hu patur milatzet lemilchama." For an example, if there is a war of choice, milchemet rashut, the chatan is not allowed to go for it. Vechen hu gam din mi shebana bayit or nata kerem, as we mentioned before, if you built a home or if you have a vineyard, so to speak, you're not allowed to go to war. So I'm going to finish with the last mitzvah, as we call lamulet haben sheneemar uvayom hashmini yemul besar orlato. So we're obligated, of course, to do the brit milah. By the way, just so you know, it's the 8th day. Why it's the 8th day? Because a baby has to have Shabbat, and of course, on the 8th day, something amazing happened. There is a vitamin K in our body, made out of the white cells, white blood cells, and this. Only on the 8th day it goes above nature, and this is what clogs the bleeding to 110%. Only on the 8 days in a person's life. Sometime during the life it could be 60, 70, 80, healthy people, 90. But only on the 8th day it goes to 110% to heal the baby instantly from the, you know, removal of the orla. You know, orla is what we call ra'la. It's a part that's bad for our neshama in our body. It has to be removed. And of course, doesn't you know, the Brit Milah is obligated by the father to do. If the father refuses, of course, the mother can do it. But first comes on the Beit Din. The Beit Din has to do it. If the Beit Din doesn't do it, and the father doesn't want to do it, and Chas v'Chalila, this child was not having had the circumcision. When he's 13, he has to do it to arrange for itself. And they say, if a father does Brit Milah, Chayav Karet. You'll be removed from this world and the world to come. And a person that doesn't have Brit Milah, no matter if he grows as Jewish person, as Israeli, whatever, unless he does the Brit Milah, he's still not Jewish. And he has to go to a mikveh. And he has to, of course, today he can go to a hospital and get it done. But Brit Milah is very important to do. And this is our last and final mitzvah for this Yom Shishi, B'Shabbat Kodesh. I want to thank all of you for being with us. Please share this class. We'll continue to do Torah next week. Be'ezat Hashem, we'll start again, hopefully on Sunday. Sunday is my only day for my family, but I try to squeeze in a class or two. But in reality, as we do every day, we learn Torah every day, and we'll have our classes continue with, again, back to basics every day at 11. And next week, also on Tuesday, we add 2 classes. We do the Parashat HaShavua. God bless you. Have a wonderful Shabbat. This class will be posted on our website, neshatorah.org. And again, thank you all for being with us. God bless you. Have a wonderful Shabbat. And please encourage many, many, many people to keep Shabbat. Like last Shabbat is the first time after 71 years that they say in thousands of people that never kept Shabbat in Israel did. And the Mekubalim and 36... Hidden Righteous said that Hashem removed many, many decrees upon Israel because of these people that kept Shabbat. So Be'ezat Hashem, happy Rosh Chodesh and happy Chodesh Nisan. Have a wonderful Shabbat. Thank you for being with us. This is Rabbi Dahan from Kolel Ahavat Israel in San Diego. God bless you. Shabbat Shalom.